stand if you are able to stand out of respect for the reading of God's word. I will only read two verses, but we will look at many more. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verses 10 and 11. Then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, saying, I regret that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me and has not carried out my commands. Right. Our message for today is God regrets the disobedient. God regrets the disobedient. Amen. You may be seated. You know, God's Bible has over 66 books in it, to be exact. And most of those books, the vast majority, is all about the goodness of God and the evilness of mankind. And I would venture to say that the evilness of mankind is our disobedience to God. We're disobedient when we refuse to do what God has asked us to do.
All right.
We are disobedient when we refuse to accept Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes, when we are disobedient to God's will and God's word, there's always consequences and repercussions when we act that way. Today, we have Saul. Saul was the first king of Israel. They were disobedient in asking for a king. They like us. They see what other people got. And when we see what other people got, we want what they got. Now, it matters whether what they got is good for them. We see something that they have that we don't have.
Right.
So the nation of Israel said, we want a king. And they didn't get any old kind of king. They got a tall, handsome, good-looking, stud steed of a king named Saul. But looks can be deceiving. You may think you got something good, but ultimately it turns out to be something of detriment to you. But they got the king that they wanted. And God has to now work what he's trying to do through this king. This is what they wanted. So he worked through the king and the king down to the nation. But if you're going to be a vessel, a mouthpiece for God, and your heart is contrary to the will of God, then all those under your authority get the same punishment that you get. Saul was the first king. He was anointed by Samuel to be the king of Israel, and he was elevated by God. But when you become elevated by God, you must listen to God. Amen. Let's back up a little bit and look at 15 and 1. It says, then Samuel said to Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint you as king over his people, over Israel. Now, therefore, listen to the words of the Lord. I know that you, in your own appraisal, was nobody, Saul. I know that when you appraise yourself, you didn't think of yourself as much. You was tall, you was handsome, but you wasn't very smart. But God has saw fit for you to be the king. The people ask for a king. Oftentimes, we ask for things. We're not the most receiving of it. We're not the most deserving of it, but we ask for things from God. And God give us the desires of our heart that we ask for. And all God says is, now that I've given you what you've been asking for, I just need you to hear what I have to say.
Right.
Not only hear what I have to say, but do what I'm telling you to do.
Amen.
So Saul was elevated as king. He got his promotion. He was up there. He was the king of God's people. And Samuel, the prophet, is saying to him, listen to the words of the Lord. When God elevates you from where you are to where he wants you to be, when he elevates you from where you are to where you are you listening to his words? He's trying to tell you something. and you're closing your ears and you're wondering why things aren't the way they should be. It's because you got what you want from God, but yet you don't want to do what God has to say. If you look at Saul, it says there are specific instructions that God wants to give to those whom he elevates. First of all, he wants to punish your enemies. If God has you in a place where he wants you to be, he's raising you up and he's giving you victory over your enemies. See, the nation of Israel had some problems. They had some people that didn't like them. They had the Ites. I don't know if you remember the Ites, but you had the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amalekites. All the Ites was against them.
Right.
And when Saul became king, he had to deal with the Ites. And God says, I'll take care of your situation when I elevate you. And if you look at the text in verse 2, it says, thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel when he set himself against him on the way while he was coming up from Egypt. Amalek is not a man. Amalek is a nation. This is personification. You're turning the nation into a person. He says, I'm going to punish that nation. I'm going to punish Amalek. You remember Amalek? Amalek was the nation when Moses was trying to come up out of Egypt, when he was trying to lead the Hebrew children to their land overflowing with milk and honey. They had to come up against the Amalekites. And the Amalekites waged war against them. And Moses had to go sit up on a hill. And as long as Moses had his hands up, Joshua was down there kicking some butt. He was whooping the Ites. But Moses' hands got weary. And when his hands got weary, they started coming down. And then the Amalekites were starting to whoop up on the Israelites. So then you had Ur and his buddy come over and lift up the hands of Moses while Moses sat on the rock. And they held his hands.
Yes,
and as long as they held his hands, the nation of Israel emerged victoriously over the Amalekites. Now God is saying, in a different generation, he says, Saul, I'm going to take care of the Ites for you.
All right.
You're going to be a fighting man just like Joshua was a fighting man. But I'm going to turn over your enemies into your hands. He says, this is all I want you to do. I'm going to take care of those who are interfering with my people when they were trying to be delivered from Egypt. They're still out there. Joshua waged war against them, but now it's time to take them off the set. Verse 3 says, now go and strike Amalek and utterly destroy. I like the word utterly. That means completely. And utterly destroy all that he has and do not spare him, but put to death both man and woman, child and infant, ox and sheep, camel and donkey.
All right.
Every Ite you see, if it's a pet of the Ite, take it out. Now, God has given specific instructions to deal with the enemy of Israel. He's given these instructions to the new king of Israel, and all he had to do was follow the instructions. God has given you some instructions. All you got, he has said it plain. He says, do this, don't do that, do this, and don't do that in his word. He has called you to do some things. He says, husbands, love your wives. Wives, respect your husbands. He says, children, respect your parents. He says, if you work, you ought to eat. If you don't work, you should not eat. He says, worship and praise me. He says, consider my ways. He says, understand that you are but foolishness in my eyesight. And all of my ways are rooted in wisdom. God has told us exactly what he wanted us to do. And all we got to do is follow what he says.
Yes.
But we seem to have a problem with just following the will of God. I'm not going to read all of it to you, but Saul has been charged with going down there and taking out the Ites, take out the king, take out his wife, taking out all the men, all the women. Oh, God, how can you kill women and children? God says, if they are not of me and they are hampering my people, they need to be up out of here. You ought to say hallelujah because God wants to protect you from your enemies.
All right. right.
And he'll stop nothing short to protect his people from his enemies. Right now, by faith alone in Jesus Christ, we have been set aside as a peculiar people. You have been protected from all those out there that don't know the Lord. You're supposed to witness to them, but don't think that your end result is their end result. Your end result is eternal life in heaven. Their end result is eternal damnation in hell. So don't think that God has no separation of those whom he loves versus those who have not come into a relationship with him. Jump down to verse 9. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep, the oxen, the fatlings, the lambs, and all that was good, and were not willing to destroy them utterly. But everything despised and worthless, that they utterly destroyed. Now, back up in verse 3 it says, now go and strike Amalek. Utterly destroy all that he has. Do not spare him, but put to death both man and woman, child and infant, ox and sheep, camel and donkey. But Saul spared Agag, the king. He let the king live. He spared the best of the sheep. And he killed the sweaty runts of the sheep. Not only that, he allowed everything that was good to live. Now he's taking the place of God. He's trying to determine what's good. Only God knows what's good. So now he's trying to make himself in the place of God. And he was not willing to destroy them utterly. But everything that he thought was bad and worthless, he destroyed. Why is it that when God shows us he loves us, he gives us elevation, he promotes us, he takes us to a higher level, and he says, I just want you to study your lesson and teach a good lesson. I just want you to study the song and sing it so we won't have any problems with the song. I just want you to be the best wife you can be. I want you to be the best husband you can be. I want you to be obedient children. I want you to do good on your job. I want you to let the kingdom be seen on your job.
Amen.
Why is it that God gives us what we want, but yet some way, somehow, we allow our wisdom to enter into the mix? And that which was holy in the beginning is now defiled. Because God says our ways are but foolishness before him. Everything is going good until we get into the middle of the picture trying to do what we think is right. And when you do what you think is right and you have yet to consult with the Lord, no wonder things are breaking down all around you. Saul thought that he was smarter than God. God said through Samuel to kill everybody. But when you get away from God, things start talking to you. When you get away from God, I know God said kill everything. But Saul, wouldn't it be really good if you saved the king and let the king be put on trial and killed before everybody? Now you're thinking what makes you look good. Not really what makes God look good. God, you're going to go against what God said in order to please God? We ought to be crazy. I'm going to do what you say not do, God, because I think this is good for you. Wait a minute now. Isn't that the clay talking to the potter? God made us. We can't tell God what's right. God tells us what's right. We get the reasoning phony. Our thought pattern, our logic isn't right no more. Saul says, I'm going to keep all the good cattle. I'm going to keep all the good donkeys. I'm going to keep all the good herds of this and the herds of that because we can use this. God said that belonged to an evil nation. A little leaven spoils the whole dough. You give that which belonged to an evil nation to be mixed in with you, then you will become accepting of what they were accepting of. Before long, if it's all right for somebody to have an alternative lifestyle, to start teaching in the church of God, the next thing you know, they'll be preaching in the church of God. And you will be all right with it because we allowed it to come in. Need to kill that stuff at the door. Drop the gospel on them like it's hot. And if they don't want it, shake the dust off your feet and move on. You're not here to compromise. That's what we are now. We've compromised too much. We've compromised so much that we don't know right from wrong. We don't know up from down. We don't know bad from good. good because we've compromised so much.
Yes, sir.
Try to take a stance on something in your job place. Try to take a stance on something anywhere you go. There's always going to be somebody with, well, wait a minute now, that should be okay. Well, no, it ain't okay. It wasn't okay for God.
Amen. That's right.
Why is it okay for us? So we got to get away from trying to make up what we think is right and force that down God's throat, because God ain't hearing what we're trying to say.
Amen.
He only wants us to hear what he's trying to say.
Amen.
So Saul got up there and Saul wimped out. He kept the king. He kept the best of all the cattle and whatnot. And then he's trying to convince himself that he did the right thing. And that's just like us. We do what we want to do. The word of God says, do thus and such. And then we come back, well, but what I did was good. Why? And then you got a reason for why what you did was good.
Amen.
And it don't coincide with the word of God on no land.
That's right.
Only what you do for the Lord will last.
Amen.
If you look at the text, it says Samuel got wind of this. Go down to verses in, 10 and 11. It says, then the word of the Lord came to Samuel saying, I regret that I have made Saul king. Why? This is how God can regret you. Your disobedience. He says, for he has turned back from following me. You know when you turn back from following God? It's when you fail to do what God say do.
Amen.
If God say do this, and you do what you want to do, you have turned back from following God. He says, I regret. Let me say, you don't want God to regret you. When God regrets you, that's God's way of saying, I'm going to take my hedge of protection off of you.
Yeah.
When God regrets you, that's God's way of saying, I am going to take my mercy and grace from up off of you. You can't continue to do what you want to do at the expense of what God told you to do.
All right.
Listen, he says, I regret that I made Saul king. Why? For he has turned back from following me and has not carried out my commands. And the Bible says, and Samuel was distressed and cried out to the Lord all night. Why? Because Samuel was the one who laid hands on Saul. He didn't like the fact that the one he laid hands on abandoned his God. God says, I regret Saul. I raised him up. I made him king. I gave him a new job. I gave him a new house. I reconciled the differences in their marriage. I got them through that tough time they was going through. I got them through that sickness they was dealing with. I got them through that cancer. I got them through that diabetes. I got them through the back aches and headaches and leg aches and all kind of aches. And I did all that for them. I elevated their income. I built them a new house. And I did everything for them. But yet, they are turning away from me by not following my commands.
Amen.
You think God will continue to bless you when you turn your back against him? I say time and again, if you turn your back against God, you're turning your face towards sin.
Amen.
But if you turn your back towards sin, you're turning your face towards God.
Amen.
When you turn your back on God by not doing what God says, you, at that particular point in time, have gone too far. You've gotten out of line. You've crossed the line. So Saul crossed the line, and look. When we cross the line, we don't like nobody to tell us when we out of line. Oh, God forbid somebody come up to me and front me and tell me I'm doing something wrong. Then I want to defend myself. Listen, God says, don't shoot the messenger for the message. Look at the text. He can come on down to verse 13. It says, and Samuel came to Saul. Samuel looking for him. Samuel want to tell him what the Lord says. And Saul said to him, blessed are you, my Lord. Saul is happy because he done what he thought is good. He done placed himself in the place of God. He says, I have carried out the command of the Lord. What? You smiling, you telling yourself after you done what you were supposed to do because you want to put yourself in the place of God. You tell yourself, what? I done carried out the will of God. When? What Bible are you reading? You done got your own book in the Bible. You done added a 67th book called me. And you done fulfilled every command in that book. It says he was happy. Look at him. It says he's greeting Samuel. And Samuel like, this boy done gone crazy. It says, and Samuel came to Saul. And Saul said to him, blessed are you of the Lord. I have carried out the command of the Lord. And Samuel said to him, okay, if you did that, then what is this bleeding of the sheep in my ears and the lowing of the oxen which I hear? Wait a minute now. You done carried out the will of God. You're supposed to go down there and kill everybody.
Uh-huh.
So the only thing I'm supposed to hear are you and your soldiers partying. Saying, thank you, Jesus. Praising the Lord. We did what God called us to do.
Yes, sir.
But in the midst of the soldiers saying, victory is mine, victory is mine. Man. He hear a move. In the midst of the victory of the soldiers. Talking about victory is mine, victory is mine. He's hearing the bay of sheep. And he's saying, so. If you did everything God told you to do, why do I hear sheep baying? And why do I hear oxen moving? And now Saul has to revert to defending himself.
Yes, sir.
If you did what God said do, them not the oxen, those are not the sheep from our camp, because they're put up in the fold. These are sheep and oxen from somewhere else. So if you killed everybody, I'm not hearing no bad and
ruin. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Many times we want to explain what can't be explained.
Right.
So if you look at the text here, it says, you look at 15, and Saul said, they have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God. But the rest we have utterly destroyed. We destroyed what we wanted to kill. We put to death what we thought needed to die. We don't care about what the word of God says.
Yes,
the word of God says kill everything that moves.
Yeah.
But we gonna keep what look good to us and give it back to God, like God gonna be okay with that. Shame on you, Saul. How dare your child come to you and say, Daddy, I told you not. I know you told me not to watch TV.
All right.
But I watched it for you.
All right.
I know you like every play-by-play of the football game, and you was unable to watch it. So even though you told me not to watch TV, I turned it on, and I watched it. And if you want to sit down, I want to benefit you with what you told me not to do.
Hey!
You ain't putting up with that from your child. Guess what? We're supposed to be children of God. If we ain't going to take that mess, you think God going to take that mess?
All right. No way.
Mama Lot used to turn around driving the car and slap you in the back seat. And you wonder how her hand was that long. We could have ran off the road or something like that, man. But in some kind of way, her hand reached back there. It was long. God extends the hand of parents to reach where they need to go.
Yes, God.
Them cars was big. They ain't like these cars today. You be over the corner and bash it. Pow! Oh, Lord. She did that in love.
Amen.
That's giving me a second chance.
Amen.
But how you going to try to tell your parent that you helping them by doing what you told them not to do? I know you told me not to wear these clothes today, Mama. I know you told me, but I'm going to wear them anyway because ultimately, you're going to benefit from me wearing them. Now, wait a minute. I bought them.
All right.
I tell you what to do with them.
All right.
So you see here, you see Saul is trying to explain away his situation and stick with me because you need to understand that it ain't about trying to please me by doing what I tell you not to do. The best way to please me is to do what I tell you to do. Obedience comes before any physical act that you can do to try to satisfy the Lord. God first wants you to do what he tells you to do before you go out trying to do what you think is right to help out God. God don't need your help. He don't need your help. He didn't need your help when he parted the Red Sea. You wasn't even around. He could have called your name and you wouldn't even show up. He didn't need your help when he parted the River Jordan. He didn't need your help when he rose Jesus from the dead. He didn't need your help when he stopped time for 24 hours. He didn't need your help when he created the earth and the animals and the people. God don't need our help. Ain't nothing we can do to God but shut up and listen.
Yeah.
A And if we listen, maybe we'll understand what God wants us to do, as opposed to going off and doing our own thing. Look at verse 22. And Samuel said, has the Lord as much delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? You think God is more interested in what you got to do as opposed to what he told you to do? Stop doing what you want to do. With regards to everything you have to do in life, you can consult the Lord, and he will help you make a decision that gives him glory when you go about doing your daily routine.
Right.
If God say go to school, get on your knees and pray before you walk through the double doors. Right. If God is saying go to church, get on your knees and pray. If God is saying quit this job, make sure you're on your knees and pray. Because when you set out and try to do it your way, it don't work out. It says, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. To obey. If we can just get to the point of obeying God, we wouldn't put up with all these people trying to get us to think that their way is the right way. The church would stand up and petition a lot of stuff that's going on today.
Yes.
If we just went back to the basics and obeyed God,
Yes. Everything
will eventually begin to work itself out.
Amen.
But we refuse to obey God. That's why you see disorderliness on every level in society. People have made up their minds, I'm going to do what I want to do.
Right.
And you know, oftentimes, that what you're doing is going against the will of God. God said, drink, but don't get drunk. You go out and get drunk anyway. God said, do not cause the little ones to stumble, but yet the example you set is causing them to pull farther and farther away from God. Because that's why nowadays, half these young adults today don't want to have nothing to do with God, because they don't watch the parents after food talking about, I love the Lord, he heard my cry.
All right.
You have to do this thing God's way.
Yes.
And if you don't do it God's way, then you automatically, by default, are doing it your way. He says, and to heed than the fat of rams. To listen to him is better than paying him off or trying to bless him with the fat of rams or sacrificing animals unto him.
Right.
God is mostly interested in us hearing and doing what he says do.
Amen.
Jonah tried to circumvent that basic rule of theology. God told him, get up and go preach to Nineveh, the Assyrians. And Jonah said, I'm going to get up, but I ain't going that way. I'm going to go, but I'm going to go where I want to go. And he got up and he headed to Tarsus. And he had to go through this whole episode of being swallowed by a fish. And apparently he didn't taste too good to the fish. Because the fish had to ultimately vomit him back up on dry land. I don't blame the fish. I don't want nobody in my belly that don't listen to the Lord either. But the fish vomited him up on dry land. And then only after the fish vomited him up, then he decided to do what God said. Why is it that we got to go through hellacious situations?
Yes.
We got to be threatened within inches of our life.
Yes.
People got to die around us.
Yes.
Things got to break apart around us. Our physical bodies begin to get sick. We got to go through all this before we want to do what God said. That's almost like you can pay me now, you can pay me later.
Yeah.
You know, let me go and pay you now. Because I don't want to deal with what Jonah went through. I don't want to deal with what Paul had to go through. Paul, persecuting the church. Watching them being killed and stoned. Had to go through blindness before he decided to do what God said to him. What you got to go through before you start doing what the Lord said do.
All right.
What situations and circumstances must befall you before you realize that God is trying to get your attention? And until you acknowledge the Lord knocking at your door, it ain't going to get no better than what it is. It ain't going to get no better than what it is. Look at the text. He says, for rebellion, verse 23, is as the sin of divination. So rebellion, that's being disobedient to God. When you are disobedient to God, you look just like a witch or sorcerer. He says rebellion. Disobedience to me is like the sin of divination. I place them in the same level, on the same accord. You don't want to do what I say. I look at you as someone who likes to deal with spirit mediums. I look at you as someone who acknowledges other supernatural powers as opposed to the one and only true God. He said, that's what you do when you don't listen. He says, and insubordination is as iniquity and idolatry. You don't want to do what I tell you to do. It's just like you are a sinner who worships false gods.
Amen.
Makes you think twice about doing the will of God. And I'm going to tell you right now, listen to me closely, because I'm through playing with this thing. I don't care who I'm talking to as long as I'm speaking the word of God.
Amen.
At this particular juncture in my life. We've been doing this 10 years. I'm not looking, Lord, no, I ain't looking at numbers. I'm looking at souls.
Amen.
He told me it ain't about numbers years ago. It's about saving your soul.
Amen.
If you're walking around here playing with God.
Amen.
If you're walking around here, I know your word, God, but I'm going to do this anyway. Okay. Shame on you. It's going to catch up with you.
Amen.
Exactly.
It's going to catch up with you.
Amen.
We battle not against flesh and blood, Amen. But against spirits of the air. This is time to know the word of God and to respond by doing the word of God.
Amen.
I don't care if you're 4, 5, 6, and 7, or 77, or 87, or 57, 27, or 37, 47. It's time to get busy about doing the will of God.
All right, man. All right.
And you can't come back and talk about, I didn't do that because I thought of something better that I want to do for you. God said, no, you can keep that.
Amen.
You just prove yourself as being disobedient. You prove yourself to be a sorcerer. You prove yourself to be a sinner. You prove yourself to be one who does not love me, because if you love me, Jesus said, you will obey my commands.
That's what he said.
Amen.
And if you want to know what God say, he says, love God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and love your neighbor as yourself.
Yes,
we waste time on a bunch of pettiness.
Yeah.
We let things come and go and stop us from serving God and get in the way of our worship and our praise. And God says,
I don't care what goes down. Amen.
When life gets tough, the tough get to pray.
All right. Amen.
So if you trust in the Lord with all your heart, you're going to do his will. Look at this. It says, because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king.
My Lord.
Don't think that God won't pull you back a notch or two. Don't think that because he's God and he's omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient at the same time, that he won't tighten up your chain a little bit. See, God is not a fool. God will allow you to experience some adversity. If you know the story of Saul, and I encourage you to read it later on, you will understand that from that point on, because God took the kingdom away from him,
he was vexed.
Yes, he was.
He couldn't handle it.
Yes, sir.
God brought in this short, skinny, runt looking of a man called David.
Mm-hmm.
Saul was tall, strong, and handsome. Right. The Bible said he looked good sitting in the saddle. And God brought in short, scrawny little David. Mm-hmm. Wasn't even considered. That he said, Jesse, bring out your boys. Let me see which one God has told me is going to take over Israel.
Yes,
and he brought out all his boys. Yes. Jesse said, come out.
Yes.
And Samuel said, no, that ain't the one. Yes. Jesse said, come out, his mother. And Samuel said, no, that ain't the one the Lord told me. He said, well, that's been all the boys I got. Because Jesse didn't even consider little David.
Uh-huh.
And Samuel said, well, Is that all the boys you got? Yeah, well, I got one more, but you ain't interested in him.
Go ahead,
but bring him out. Let me see him.
Yes, sir.
Let me see him. This the one. This, well, what about his two big, tall, strong? No, this the one.
All right.
This the one right here. Yes. Why? Because there's no fear in his heart.
Amen.
Why? Because he has a heart that's after the heart of God.
Yes.
There cannot be no fear in your heart. You have to have a heart that's after the heart of God. And if your heart is after the heart of God, you're going to do what God say do. But the fact that you're not doing what God say do is proof evident that your heart is not after God. You're looking tall, dark, and handsome on your way to hell. You're looking tall, pretty, and fine on your way to hell. Because God is more interested in a scrawny pipsqueak that has a heart after him than he does a tall, dark, handsome, fine man or woman that want to do it their way. And just let the years pass by. That handsomeness and that prettiness is going to fade away. It's going to fade away. But your heart after the heart of God's will never go away if you resign yourself to follow the Lord. So on your job, follow the Lord. At your school, follow the Lord. When you're witnessing, follow God. Don't let nobody talk you into doing what they think is right. Don't you talk yourself into saying, I don't think I need to go to church. The Bible says, do not forsake the fellowship of the saints. Right. Don't sit up and think that you don't have to eventually serve in the kingdom, because God says this is a ministry unto everlasting life. Each finger relies upon the hand. Each hand relies upon the arm. Each arm relies upon the upper arm, which relies upon the shoulder, which relies upon the neck, which is attached to the other shoulder, and the other upper arm, and the other arm, and the other hand, which goes down the thorax. And everything in this church is tied together. We are one. We've got to give God glory on one. When we see somebody cutting up, we need to pray for them. We need to pray with them. We need to expound upon the kingdom by loving our neighbors as ourselves and stop doing what we want to do. I'm going to tell you what we want to do. We want to say, I ain't got time for that person. I don't need to mess with them. I got my own problems. I got my own money. If they ain't got no money, they're going to have to find their own, because it took me too hard to get what I got. I ain't going to deal with that. I don't need to visit the sick. Ain't nobody going to come visit me when I'm sick. I'm going to do what I want to do. But I love the Lord. Well, God, I didn't go visit them because I accepted Jesus Christ, and that was enough. God going to say, get thee behind me. I never knew you. You're going to call yourself ministers of Jesus Christ, having accepted Christ, but you won't visit the sick. You won't come to Sunday school. You won't come to Bible study. You want to do things the way you want to do it. And God says, it ain't about what you want to do. It ain't about what you want to do. His kingdom is forever. And it starts right here.
My Lord.
Who are we?
My Lord.
Who are we? Are we Sauls? Or are we David?
Oh, Lord.
Who are we? Who are we?
Amen.
Isn't it better when you do it God's way?
Yes.
Because when you do it God's way, there's fringe benefits involved. You do it God's way, things tend to work out. They may not work on our schedule, but they work on time.
Amen.
They work when they need to work. If you just trust in God and give your heart to him, he will not be regretful of you. Don't let God regret you. God wants to smile and to be thankful that he elevated you and called you into his ministry. Most gracious Father in heaven, Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus.